Hayes, everybody.
Okay, my speech or my presentation on sections today is going to be a disappointment after Chad's eloquent presentation. It's going to be pretty informal. I'm going to do some foraging. I'm going to talk about sections. That's probably the most question I get asked is, how do you create a good section? How do you make such a smooth transition in a shoe? How do you make a clean shoe? We all see pictures of Fred Turka's shoes on Facebook. How does it get them so flat? How does it get the perfect section, perfect transition? I'm going to talk about a lot of those things that he does today. I might do it a little bit different than Craig, but the result is the same. So that's what I'm going to achieve. And if you have any questions while I'm in the process, that's what we're all here for. So don't hesitate to ask. I'm not a very good public speaker, so just ask questions. If you want to come up closer, get a look, feel free to do that. That's what we're all here for. Yes, sir. My definition of a section is a perfect section is slightly thicker on the outside of the shoe, thinner on the inside, but not have sole pressure, and uniformity, I would say. We take, for example, we have a roadster that's built for wear. We want a nice, big, wide toe, but we want to have a smooth transition to the branches, and we want to have a smooth transition to the heel box. And during that whole process of shoemaking, I'm trying to counteract the scorching in that section. But when I fuller it, I'm going to blow my fullering out, I'm going to thin my outside edges with my fuller. So I'm going to have to counteract everything my fuller is doing during the whole shoemaking process. I'm going to be making a wedge-shaped section while I'm drawing that shoe out. So I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to make a grade by one shoe, which is a perfect example of 10 and a half inches, which is a perfect example of how to create a section. How to draw that 1-inch stock down the 7-inch section. Okay? Does that make sense to everyone? So when I'm constantly, I'm going to take a cross section, then we have 3-inch by 3-quarter section. So we're making a 3-quarter fuller shoe. When I'm fulling that, that outside edge, my outside edge thin, my inside edge constantly gets thicker. If I'm turning the shoe, the outside edge is getting thinner, my inside edge is creating full range. So everything I do during the shoe making process is going to counteract that. I have to create a thicker outside edge and a thinner inside edge. I'm always doing that during the shoe making process. And a lot of times I get asked questions when I'm judging. Well, what separated the middle of the pack to the top shoes? Oftentimes this. What we've got to create a thicker outline edge to make that a clean looking shoe. To make everything look okay. Okay? But when I bump my toe, same thing. I gotta create this section here. I gotta maintain a thick outside edge. Our tightest radius on our shoe is at our toe. So we're going to thin that toe. So we need to thicken that outside edge on that shoe alone. Okay? Any questions on that part? Okay, I have 11 and a half inches of 3 3/4. I'm going to put a bump in the toe, and I'm going to thank you. trying to get keep my outside edge here within that. I'm constantly making a wedge. If I'm making a journey in front, or I'm making a roadster, this is how the section's always being drawn out.
Then I probably put,
I probably put a half an inch in his toe, but I threw it back out. It probably made me to create that remark. Too. And I'm creating that with a horn. So I'm actually creating a pyramid. I probably get half as much blowout on the inside of my section as I do the outside of my section. So this is constantly, we all get a bubble here. On the inside of our section too. So you watch Craig, you hit a piece of steel on the horn. He's got that angle, and he can hit me that inside as well. Okay? Well, essentially, I'm trying to make a pyramid, but not a symmetrical pyramid. I'm trying to just create a flat angle here, more of an angle on the outside. Thank you for your question.
Okay, awesome. So you're not having just the depth of your point, you're having the entire stock, thickness of the stock then?
Yeah. I'm hemming it all the way from the ground surface all the way to the foot surface.
Well, from the board to the foot surface, do that, or why do you hem past the depth of the board it would be?
I'll have that. Josh asked a good question. You typically, a perfect fullering is going to fuller two-thirds of the depth of the stock. So why am I hemming all the way from the ground surface to the foot surface? So when we hem, I've heard it said a lot of times that we hem two-thirds the depth of the stock. So when I go in hem my section, I would hem like that. Okay? But I don't believe metal behaves that way. I think when we sink that fuller in, transfer all of that force like that, and this is more our pivot point here. okay? I don't think we magically create a pivot point right here, okay? So I think if we give two-thirds of the stock, this is what we get. We get a round outside edge, and we still have that corner really thin. So I try to create a straight line all the way from the foot surface to the ground surface when I hit. And a lot of people give them two-thirds of the stock, but I've always found I have a round, non-crisp shoe when I get done. Any questions on that? Yes, sir.
You always set up and hem on the street like that?
I normally hem on the horn, but for demonstration purposes, I was wanting to make a crisp section. One thing that happens is you lose a lot of your material when you turn the branch. So I like to turn the branch, regather up on the horn. But when I was starting out shoemaking, I preferred to do it in the straight because it was easier. I could keep parallel lines on my shoes. I could keep parallel lines on my fullery, mark my fullery, turn and fullery. And I made nice shoes because of it. But especially on a hind shoe, when you set it up in the straight, you're gonna tight bend here. You're gonna thin that outside edge. And then when you go to put your sandbox on it or try to flatten it, you're gonna have a void here on this outside edge, typically. So I think that's one thing a lot of guys are really good at these days is smooth transitions on the horn. And that's the hardest thing to learn in shoemaking. I didn't learn how to use the horn until recently. I mean, it's just one of those things where you just, a lot of guys are advocates for making shoes in the straight. You know, it's simpler on making sections and stuff, but your end product's not as good because you're losing that outside edge. And I think this distorts as well. When you go to fuller that, these don't make parallel lines. When you have a tighter bend here, you're stretching this more, this becomes finer, and it doesn't stay exact. So I like to turn everything and keep everything parallel on the curve. And it's just the hardest thing. Okay. Any other questions? And I'll do this one, I'll turn it and set it up for fuller like that.
Counter in. Our fullery is blowing out here, and then
her heel, or losing wind with her heel, one more torque in her heels. So then we have a uniform section, uniform section, uniform section, and then we have a mini heel here. This will be the lateral heel. So when I go to make that, I need to pack material into that heel.
Thank you.
classes here at convention used to be the hunter class. Was it 11 inches of preschool one? We had to make hind shoes at 11 inches, and we had to draw it out. And it was the best teacher teaching you how to make sections and keep your section and draw it out and make a decent size shoe, a 7/8 section at the end. So I think this is 2.5 inches. I cut it off a little bit short. But I'm going to just run this out and just show you the process that I did. The shoe probably taught me more about forging sections than anything. And I made piles of the shoe. And I'm going to hold on to the lateral heel. I'm going to leave that alone. I'm going to draw it. I'm going to just barely run through the toe. And I'm going to draw it a little forward and start again. I'm essentially going to create that at the beginning. Okay? Everything up for the future.
Thank you.
happens to be after I turn it. Close my fullering up just a little bit, and then I can open it up. I'll pass this around, but I lost my outside edge here, right here in the quarter. And that's what tends to happen to me when I float things in the street.
Questions on that part?
if I just suddenly go on the far side of the barn, I'm going to bend my branch. If I suddenly go on the near side of the barn, I'm going to straighten the branch. So I'm constantly shaping. And that's something that just takes a lot of time to figure out. But it makes a crisper section. It makes you more efficient and larger. You can turn, pin, shape, fuller, all in the same heat. Once you get proficient on these moves here on the barn. And then that helps you crisp it up. So that's one thing you can do on the last heat. You go back up and crisp up the section, take out the lumps and bumps. And then that also, you can shake your shoe on the last heat as well. So that these techniques here really help you.
Thank you for having me.